Brian, how about a preview of these enhancements?
Well, the first one is spectrum efficiency. Basically, an Astro Digital Radio can operate on a narrower bandwidth than analog radio. Astro Digital Radio will provide the opportunity to create more two-way channels and make more efficient use of the RF spectrum in the future. The second enhancement is audio quality. Motorola's advanced digital radios will feature superior voice quality. And because of the way advanced digital radio handles two-way voice communications, it can provide higher quality audio over a larger portion of our customers' radio system coverage areas. The next major enhancement we'll talk about is signaling capability. Basically, Astro Digital radios have the capability to do much more signaling on voice channels. One more important enhancement offered by Astro is the ability to mix data traffic and voice radios on the same channel.
While we're talking about these enhancements, we'll cover the basics of how Motorola's Astro Digital Radio systems work, and you'll hear some of the new technology terms. Our next topic of discussion will be standards. As you'll see, Motorola is supporting an important set of standards for digital radio that are designed to promote compatibility and interoperability. And finally, we'll discuss Motorola's plans to make these new digital radios compatible with current analog radio systems. We'll talk about backward compatibility and several migration paths to Astro Digital Radio systems. That's an ambitious agenda. Jim, will you start us off and tell us what is the difference between an analog and a digital radio transmission?
I'd be glad to, Tom. Let's look at an analog radio transmission first. An analog radio signal is transmitted as a continuously varying wave that looks like this. This is the kind of signal that is typically sent by today's two-way FM voice radios. This analog or continuously varying wave signal has always been a most effective way to carry the continuously varying sounds of the human voice. At the transmitting radio, changes in voice sounds cause matching changes in the frequency of the radio wave. At the receiving radio, changes in the frequency of the radio wave are translated back into the original changes in voice sounds. A digital signal is a radio signal with abrupt changes or shifts. Instead of the traditional varying waveform, the radio carrier is shifted between discrete frequencies. This is called frequency shift keying, or FSK. This modulated radio signal is highly efficient for transmitting digital data. The signal values can carry any data stream made up of zeros and ones. That's what digital data is, coded communication information in a 0-1 or binary computer data format.
Well, we've had the ability to transmit digital data for a while now. We've been doing it for years with GoLay binary paging, mobile data terminals, and SecureNet encrypted radios.
That's absolutely right. But now what's new is the improved, more efficient method of frequency shift keying we're using to modulate the radio signal that carries the digital information. You see, we're using a four-value modulation method for advanced digital radio transmissions. This four-value modulation allows us to transmit much more digital information than existing two-value modulation methods. In Astro Digital systems, we use four-value FSK modulation to transmit all our two-way communications. That includes data, two-way voice, and all of our traditional analog control signaling, such as PL codes and repeater access tones.
I thought you said earlier that this four-value modulation method was only good for data. And how are we going to use it to transmit our analog tone control signals or the sounds of the human voice?
Tom, our advanced digital radios will convert analog voice sounds into coded digital information. This prepares the voice to be transmitted via four-value FSK.
Let's back up a minute. Jim said that an analog radio signal is the most natural carrier for the human voice. Radio users will want to know why we're bothering to convert voice for digital transmission.
Well, the reason is this, Tom. The new advanced digital technologies have actually changed the rules. We're going to be able to transmit and receive a digital voice signal that is superior in audio quality to an analog signal.
And there are a lot of other advantages to advanced digital radio. The rest of our discussion will focus on the Astro Digital advantages we see for the future.
And the first advantage of moving to Astro Digital Voice is that Astro radios transmit and receive using narrow bandwidth signals. Using Astro technology, a digital voice channel will require only half the channel space used by today's 25 kilohertz analog voice radios. Astro radio technology gives us the potential to double the number of available two-way voice channels. We expect this spectrum-efficient Astro digital technology to be applied to the VHF, UHF, and 800 megahertz bands.
There are several ways current channel assignments could be changed to take advantage of the narrow band capability. Well, for example, a government agency could apply to have an analog channel split into two digital channels. These two digital channels would then carry double the amount of radio traffic.
Or another scenario is that a new narrow band digital radio channel could be placed on center of the old wide band channel. Now, this would result in increased separation and reduced interference from adjacent channels. As a next step in the future, after adjacent channels change to narrowband, new digital channels could be inserted in between them.
Jim, take a minute to explain how Motorola's Astro digital technology makes this possible.
What Motorola has really done with our advanced digital technology is developed a way to convert high-quality voice into a digital code and then to transmit that code as part of a narrow bandwidth digital signal. With Astro, this digital voice signal can be transmitted accurately inside a 12.5 kilohertz channel space. As Ann pointed out, that's half the channel space currently allocated for a wideband analog voice channel.
Jim, I know that our new products use several distinct functional steps to get digital voice on narrow band channels. I think it would help all of us understand the Astro digital process better if you could go through it step by step.
Okay. We're going to look at a functional block diagram of a Motorola Astro digital radio. This first step is the same as it's always been. The mic picks up analog sound waves representing the flowing pitch and intensity of the human voice. Next, the voice signal from the mic is digitized. A DSP, or digital signal processor, is a specialized Motorola microprocessor. One of the functions it performs is called vocoding. The vocoder converts the voice signal into a very tightly coded stream of digital words. The stream of digital words will be transmitted as part of the four-value FSK modulated signal. With digital transmission, bandwidth is determined by the data bits per second transmitted. Because the stream of voice data words is so tightly coded by the advanced DSP technology, the digital signal can be transmitted in a very narrow bandwidth.
We should point out that the customer can choose clear digital voice or can select an option for digital encryption. And digital encryption does not increase the bandwidth.
So what all of this means is that Astro digital voice, either clear or encrypted, can be transmitted using FSK modulation on a narrower bandwidth than traditional analog voice radios require. And we have the potential for much more efficient use of the radio spectrum.
Well, that's one major advantage to every radio user. The second one is high quality audio.
Now, when you say that Astro digital radio means improved audio quality, I want to know how it's different from what we're used to hearing on SecureNet digital radios.
Well, the key difference lies in how we're vocoding the voice signal. Our powerful Motorola digital signal processor uses an advanced vocoding method to more accurately reproduce the human voice.
In fact, the new digital voice and encrypted digital voice sound the same and are comparable to clear analog voice.
Well, that's right, Ann. To Astro's digital voice signal, we add error protection information. Then we transmit the digital signal via FSK. Error protection allows the receiving Astro radio to detect and correct errors which can result from the radio transmission of the digital signal. Our whole Astro digital process creates a very robust digital voice signal for the two-way radio environment.
The steps of precisely coding human voice, adding error protection, and then accurately transmitting this digital information are Astro's keys to the dramatic improvement in audio quality over existing digital radio systems.
That's right. Because the Astro signal is so robust, it can actually sound better than clear analog voice radio under moderate signal strength conditions with some fading. Let's listen to a demonstration comparing an Astro digital transmission with an analog voice transmission in a moving van. Moderate signal strength with some fading is a typical RF condition encountered in moving vehicles. This is an analog signal.
The clean deck means a neat color. Couch cover and wall drapes were blue. The stems of the tall glasses cracked and broke. The wall phone rang loud and often.
This is an Astro digital signal.
The clean deck means a neat color. The couch cover and the hall drapes were blue. The stems of the tall glasses cracked and broke. The wall phone rang loud and often.
Wow, that is high quality audio.
It sure is, Tom. Those demonstrations were both recorded under the same moderate signal strength conditions. Astro was better under those common conditions. Well, what's more, it is still better under even tougher RF conditions.
Everyone is aware of what fade and flutter do to an analog voice signal as a radio moves around in areas of weak RF coverage. With Astro, error detection and correction reduce the effects of fading, flutter, and interference. Instead of talking about it, let's listen to a couple more transmissions. This time, the receiving radios are in a moving vehicle traveling near the outer edges of the RF system range. First, you will hear an analog voice transmission.
The music played on while they talked. It's been for the best on a day like this. The bunch of grapes was pressed into wine. He sent the figs but kept the ripe cherries.
Now you'll hear Astro receive the same transmission.
The music played on while they talked. Dispense with a vest on a day like this. The bunch of grapes was pressed into wine. He sent the figs but kept the ripe cherries.
Very impressive. The superior quality of the digital voice transmission is a result of the error detection and correction done by the receiving Astro radio. Our advanced digital radios can actually reconstruct lost sounds. This is something that's just not possible with the analog voice. What it means is that Astro audio quality remains high even as the user moves into the fringe areas and the signal gets weaker.
So there's a clear conclusion we can draw about Astro digital voice. Astro will consistently retain a very high level of audio quality over a greater portion of the coverage area of a radio system.
Well, that sums it up, Tom.
Let's now turn our attention to the improvements in signaling that are possible using Astro digital radio. Ann, why don't you start?
In analog radio systems today, we depend on many different types of signaling. Audible tone signals such as dual tone multi-frequency and sub-audible tone signals such as PL continuous tone-coded squelch signals. We also use preamble signals such as those sent in StatAlert advanced conventional systems.
Signaling is important to the operation of almost every large radio system. The problem is these control signals have to compete with voice communications for space and time on the radio channel. And because normal voice takes up most of the space and time on the available analog channel, there is very little left for signaling. Transmitting voice with our Astro digital radio technology gives us a tremendous increase in the amount of channel space and time for informational and control signaling. Analog control signals are replaced by high-speed digital signals. These digital signals are embedded in the digital coded voice stream and transmitted. We expect in the future to be able to use this additional embedded signaling capacity for a wide variety of applications. The increase in our signaling capability will hold true in conventional, trunked, and encrypted systems.
From the Astro radio user's point of view, there are several major advantages. Preamble signals won't cut off the beginning of voice messages. Delayed system access caused by lengthy preamble signals will also be eliminated. Users will no longer have to listen to annoying data bursts or signal tones. And because the embedded digital signaling is sent continuously, signal information like ID, emergency, and network control is communicated more reliably. Continuously embedded signaling is immune to interference or other interruptions which can destroy preamble signaling.
Let's talk about text data as we know it today. How will Astro Digital Radio handle text data, Jim?
Astro Digital Radios will handle data more efficiently and provide increased capacity for many new data services. This system is designed to meet the growing needs for compatible voice and data information throughout public safety and other large private radio systems. The Astro System Protocol allows Astro Voice Radios and Astro Data Terminals to access the same radio channels without interfering with each other.
So far, we've talked about some major advantages of Astro Digital Radio. Advantages like spectrum efficiency, superior audio quality, enhanced signaling capacity, and integrated voice and text data communications. In addition, Astro delivers enhanced encryption capabilities. Now, all of these enhancements will apply in conventional, trunked, and encrypted systems. Astro Digital Radios will provide solutions for large private radio systems where voice, data, enhanced control signaling, and encryption are common needs.
With the emergence of digital radio technology, all of us see the need to develop standards for compatibility and interoperability. Motorola's position is that standards for advanced digital radio systems will benefit everyone. Consequently, we've been actively involved in the development of digital standards. The overall goal of developing standards is to assure interoperability and allow users to purchase compatible digital radios from multiple sources.
Well, now we've covered the major enhancements that Astro Radio will offer. Assume for a minute that Astro Digital Radio is the right move for a customer. Let's talk about how that customer can plan the move easily and economically.
We all recognize that the kind of customers who want to move to Astro already have a significant investment in conventional, trunked, or SecureNet digital radio equipment. Our Astro digital radios will be designed for interoperability and backward compatibility with their current Motorola systems. Astro radios will facilitate a graceful migration for customers who can benefit from the addition of digital radio capabilities. A great deal of research and development has gone into building the narrow bandwidth capabilities of Astro Digital Radio. At the same time, to support our customers' migrations, Motorola Astro Digital Radios will also interoperate with voice radios operating on the wide bandwidth analog channels. With your own ears, you've heard the improved audio quality of Astro Digital Radio. However, our new digital radios will also transmit and receive clear analog and SecureNet voice. We've talked about the expanded signaling capacity of Astro Digital Radio, but when operating in the analog mode, our new radios will still be able to do traditional analog signaling. This backward compatibility that we've taken care to design into these new radios will allow Astro customers to go through a gradual migration process.
And we've come up with a variety of options for customers as they plan their move to Astro Digital Radio. Customers can make the change on a radio-by-radio, channel-by-channel, or region-by-region basis.
I'd like to thank each of our panel members for helping us to begin to understand some of the basics of digital technology and Astro Digital solutions. Astro Digital is one of the many different communication solutions Motorola can provide.
The year is 2000. America has regained its competitive edge in wireless communications because radio frequency grants were made in the early 1990s. A new era of untethered communications has emerged with new products, industries, and systems. What follows is a vision of this wireless society.
Janice Hughes.
Janice? It's Bill.
Hey, how did it go at Advantech?
They want to see numbers on 14 A29s and a timetable Friday morning. Now, that only gives us 3 days, so we got to move quickly.
14? Bill, that's almost $100 million.
But I'm not sure we can retool the A29 to meet their specs.
Ouch.
Yeah, I know, and they're putting it out for bids, of course. The Swiss, the Japanese.
We can't lose this account. You know, I hate to bother Steve, but...
We just can't wait.
I know. Steve, sorry to bother you, but Bill Friedman just called from Dallas. He's got a shot at Advantech. They want a modification on the A29. 14 units and a complete proposal by Friday morning.
14 units? That's great. So what kind of modification are we talking about?
Some sort of structural change. Bill has the specs.
Have Bill call me. Maybe we can figure it out. And better yet, set up a conference call between our team and John Abrams.
John Abrams.
The one and only. A29 was his baby. Last time I heard, he was in Baltimore. See if you can find him.
I'll see what I can do, and I'll get back to you in a few minutes.
Trauma Central, this is Unit 42 with Trauma Alert, requesting priority comm link. Repeat, Trauma Alert.
Ambulance 42, this is Trauma Central. Proceed with patient status.
MVA victim with open leg fracture and small laceration with an arterial bleed in the left neck area. We applied pressure to wound and immobilized neck. I'm stabilizing and splinting the leg. Blood pressure 100 over 60.
Ambulance 42, message received. Transmit EKG data and ECU of lacerated area. I'm giving you a comm link with Dr. Chu. Prepare for video transfer.
Affirmative. Video transfer ready.
Okay, 43, now online. EKG irregular. Atrial fibrillation with an occasional PVC. Keep pressure to the neck area. Our leg can wait.
John, we really appreciate your willingness to work up this situation with us. Bill, why don't you get us started?
Okay, here it is in a nutshell. Advantech wants 14 A29 units retooled to their specs.
John, what do you think?
I can't tell you anything until I see their specs.
John, let me fax it to you.
Got it. I think I know what they want.
Dispatch, this is Curry Teen at Memorial Hospital. I'm faxing the victim's ID for an next of kin notification. Next of kin is listed as his father, Jack Croft.
10-4 Curry Teen will contact him.
How about that?
Stable.
42, don't restrict his airway. Apply pressure enough to control bleeding. Yeah, that's better. Color's good. Check BP.
The atrium's ready for ASTM inspection, so try to set that up for tomorrow, okay? And we need 18 bundles of 2.5-inch studs.
18 bundles of 2.5-inch.
Listen, let me call you back, okay? I got another call. Hello?
Jack Croft?
Yeah, that's me.
Mr. Croft, this is the Metro Police Department.
Yeah?
Your son has been involved in a serious accident. He's being rushed to Memorial Hospital.
I think I've got something on tag cam, Steve.
Great. Let's see.
Unit 42, American lane's all tied up. Follow me west on Foster.
10-4, right behind you.
How's the EKG? Any improvement?
Normal. Sinus rhythm rate 70. Still an occasional PVC.
You see, Steve, basically we're just tweaking the angle on the rotation arm. It's only about a 10-degree difference.
Wait a second.
Won't the new 840 meet their specs without a modification?
Yeah, but it's not ready.
John, for a $100 million order, we'll make it ready.
All right, Trauma Central. Looks like our ETA is about 3 to 4 minutes.
Message received, 42. We're expecting you in 3. He appears to be out of the woods. Good work, guys.
Now, everyone's set. John, you're putting together an engineering timetable with costs. Janice, you're pulling together the 840 Liverture. Bill, when are you presenting this?
Friday morning, 10 o'clock.
Great. And Bill, congratulations on getting us in on this bid. And all of you showed some great teamwork here. Thanks.
Hi, hon, it's me. You still at the office?
Oh, hi, Phil. What a day. You wouldn't believe it. What have you been up to?
Oh, the usual.
I'm swamped. Do you think you could pick up Linda?
Sorry, Jan. I'm still on call till 8.
Well, tell you what, I'll call Dad. He'll take care of it. Talk to you later.
Linda, are you sure you don't want to ride?
No, it's okay. My mom should be here really soon.
Okay.
Okay, bye.
See ya.
Hello?
Hi, Linda. It's Mom.
Mom, are you coming to get me or not? I've been waiting here forever.
I'm sorry, honey. I'm all tied up here. Grandpa's on his way to pick you up, so just stay put and he'll be there in a few minutes, okay?
Oh, okay. Bye.
A wireless society by the year 2000. Is this just science fiction or an imminent fact? Current technology is advancing at a rate that makes what you've just witnessed entirely plausible. Unless we unleash the full potential of the RF spectrum, this vision for the future will never come to pass.
A tour that I was given of the Customer Satisfaction Center, the CSC, which used to be the IDC in Chicago, as well as the some of the system tests that went on, and also the Evolution 92 Roadshow in Chicago, May 1992. Well, this isn't a perfect golf example. I thought we might as well get into the swing of things here. This is the Penny Lane CSC, which used to be IDC. Training is located on the upper floor, and the system staging and administration is on the lower floor. This is one of the training rooms. Woody Palmer gave us a description of the kind of training that they offer. They happen to be doing a paging class in this room. That's a VME. These are the tests that they were doing while we were there. Capricorn, WEPCO, and Falcon, as well as China Light and Power. China Light and Power was the smart zone system, second smart zone system, which is probably shipped by now. The first one being a state and local entity in Louisiana. This was a paging terminal that they were staging, an MPS 2000, which is the successor to the old MetroPage 200 terminal. They have all kinds of various power available in the CSC. That's Gallo Enriquez. They have 220 volt, 120, 1560 hertz generator backup. This area was used to stage the Guam system, and back in that room is the China Power and Light system, which is a three-site smart zone system. They were waiting for firmware, so it wasn't actually operational. They couldn't test it while we were there, but going through the initial cabling and setup, those are the central electronics banks for the console. This is this smart zone controller, the front, made by a company called IMP in England. That's the front panel. This is the new daughter board in the front of the trunking controller. This is the back of the zone controller. It's fully redundant. This is the back of one of the trunk controllers. This is their system diagram for the China Power and Light system. Three remote sites. Zone controller and an audio switch and an MBX. The model number of the audio switch. It's a T1 audio switch. 6.9 volt power supply is redundant. This is the back with the rails on the top and the bottom are the power. They do shipping from CSC in vapor packed containers, so you can tell if they've been tampered with. This is the equipment waiting to ship on those shelves back there in the packing area. We are entering the Evolution 92 show at the Hyatt Regency O'Hare in Chicago near the airport. The entryway is not as auspicious as they had planned because of the configuration of the room, but there are booths scattered around mostly the outside of the room, and in the back of the room, as you see there, was a dispatch center with consoles and some other equipment. They had a little bit of history of Motorola, some of the technological advancements shown with our portables, up to the new Jedi portable, some single sideband equipment, some of the new GPS equipment from GEG. That's a new little portable with a GPS antenna on top. New marine navigation system. They happen to have a database of Florida in there, which you could fool with. It's the new handheld GPS receiver. Hopefully we'll be able to sell this equipment one of these days. So you could zoom in on different parts of the globe and find out where you were and where you wanted to go to. Southern tip of Florida. This is the HP calculator or computer. It had all kinds of various video screen interactive systems. We went during a portion of the day where it was employees only. So it was the manning of the booths was rather limited, and some of the equipment was locked up, such as some of the portables. New paging terminal, call box. It's a new fax machine for SmartNet. 4,800 baud in one direction and 2,400 baud in the other. Coverage plus terminals, then BARC. You can see the little pager in front of the computer terminal for receiving text and messages and files. Several different mobiles on display. Nothing particularly new on the mobile side. desktop consoles, consolettes. Notice the Jedi portables are missing. That was a fish tank that had a portable in there. The new submersible saber. No cellular. This was an old portable that had survived a fire. They had it on display on the wall, showing that radios do survive very bad treatment. Pretty melted, but it was still working. Start site controller. Another system watch screen. They had a system link there on display, which is a Raven VF switch. Some of the touchscreens were Macintosh-based, some of them were IBM-based. You can freeze frame if you want to read some of these a little better. That's a Jedi portable, MTS-2000, with a StatAlert compact console. This is the new T5620 StatAlert console with the new added LCD display on top. This is the Portable 2 portable repeater with the modules for future expansion on the left-hand side. Saber Converticom. New ruggedized saber sitting in the aquarium, getting wet. It has a sort of a sliding clip that separates the battery from the portable to keep it waterproof. And key manager, KMC there demonstrating OTAR and multi-key. There it is on the bottom. This is the new Quantar repeater. VHF only at the moment. That's the station control module. That's the power amplifier module. Not approved by the FCC yet, you notice. This was the backside with the shield panel. And this was one sort of behind the display that was actually operational with the various cables running around on the back, RF cables. So they're actually repeating Astro through that repeater. That's a new speaker microphone control head. That's an Astro mobile talking to another Astro mobile. They made various improvements in the quality of the Astro radio over time. That's a smart zone controller again. And here's some of the sounds of this particular smart zone touchscreen interactive.
Touch any component for definition. Radio registration. Mobile A at Site 1 turns on the radio. It scans for the control channel and locks on to Site 1, then sends in its talk group affiliation. The radio's current talk group and ID are sent down the control link to the zone controller. The zone controller notes what control link port the information came in on to determine the site of registration. The same thing happens with other mobiles when they turn on their radios. In this case, Mobile A, Mobile C, and Mobile D are on Talk Group 1, and Mobile B is on Talk Group 2. The zone controller receives the information and stores it in the Talk Group to Site Registration table for future reference.
Press next.
Call request. The zone controller receives the call request from Mobile A for a group call on Talk Group 1. The zone controller then reviews its Talk Group site affiliation information to determine where all Talk Group 1 members are located. The zone controller assigns a voice channel to each site where Talk Group 1 members are located. Audio switch setup. The zone controller sends data to the audio switch, so it knows what sites and channels need to receive the audio coming from Site 1. Here, Site 1 audio needs to be routed to Sites 1 and 3 on the assigned channels for the Talk Group 1 conversation. If console operator positions were connected, the audio would also be routed to those positions with Talk Group 1 control modules. Radio channel assignment. The zone controller sends the voice channel assignments to sites 1 and 3. The transmit and receive channel assignments are sent to the radios over the control channel. Mobile A begins transmitting on the assigned channel at site 1, and Mobile C listens to the assigned channel at site 3.
Dynamic site.
Without dynamic site assignment, the active Talk Group 1 call prevents Talk Group 2 from getting a channel at Site 3. Talk Group 2 conversations cannot begin since the channel is already busy for Talk Group 1, even though no Talk Group 1 members are at Site 3. The Talk Group 2 request goes into the busy queue. With dynamic site assignment, the active Talk Group 1 call only uses channels at sites 1 and 2 to reach Talk Group 1 members. Talk Group 1 does not require a channel at Site 3 since there are no Talk Group 1 members present. The channel is now assigned to handle the Talk Group 2 call. Busy override example. Before override. Talk Group 1 conversation cannot begin until channels are available at all sites where Talk Group 1 members are registered. Busy override example. After override. Busy override allows Talk Group 1 members to converse at sites 1 and 2. Talk Group 1 members at Site 3 will join the conversation when a channel becomes available. Critical site example. Critical site is busy. Talk Group 1 conversation cannot begin until channels are available at all critical sites. Critical site example. Channel is available at critical site. Radios at Site 1 will join the conversation when a channel becomes available for Talk Group 1. Talk Group 1 conversation can now begin since a channel is available at the channel site. Critical user example. A site is busy. Talk Group 1 conversation cannot begin until channels are available at all sites where Talk Group 1 members are registered. Critical user example. A call is placed. The call goes through at the site of the critical user and other available sites. Talk Group 1 members at Site 3 will join the conversation when a channel becomes available.
Screen. Another version of the system link. Here is actually is the guts of the system link. A bunch of plug-in cards, fairly low technology cards. It's a simple DTMF switch. Here was a Centricom console they had set up with some of the E911 CRT consoles and telephone instruments. Here's the SmartNet fax capability, fax machine. Here was a little test bench they had set up in the back of the room, as well as an area of fixed equipment on display. It's a Telstar 2 gig microwave link. It's the cards with the RF jumpers on the front. NCP500 set up as an RF demo. The back of a start site controller. Here's the embassy switch. The fan kit blowing madly on the top with the two power supplies on the bottom. Quantar base station. Actually, that's an MSF3 base station. And the back of the here's another SIMS2 terminal with some RIM boxes. And an RF modem. Here's the back of the MSF with the J-box facing towards the rear of the station on a bracket panel in the middle of the station. It's the inside of a DARCOM unit. There's the outside, DARCOM 2. Fairly small box. Altair Plus which is a wireless Ethernet, 18 gigahertz. Here's some MDD software running utility software and a KDT. Grid laptop hooked up to a KDT. There's the 405 radio built into the IBM PC radio. Above is the UHF radio packet modem. That also has a Motorola radio in it, so I think it's a Psion terminal. This is a MOSCAD unit with the individual modules that remove, and the front covers that open up to expose removable terminal strips. That was the control module, CPU module. Next to it is an I/O module with the separate screw terminal strips. Wires come out the bottom of the hole, easily documented. And lastly, they had various brochures describing some of the other aspects of Motorola. Thanks for watching this brief introduction to Evolution 92, and let's charge into battle and get some more business.